Good evening and Jai Bhim to all. Once again, welcome to our virtual reading session. So we'll start our session today. I request Dr. Shanta to please continue.
Thank you. Welcome all, Jai Bhim. Welcome to the Alienation of Caste Part 4, Section 9. Not only has the Hindu made no effort for the humanitarian cause of the civilizing the savages, but the high caste Hindus have deliberately prevented the lower caste who are within the pale of Hinduism from rising to the cultural level of the higher caste. I will give two instances, one of the Sonars and other of the Pathari Prabhus. Both are communities quite well known in Maharashtra. Like the rest of the communities desiring to raise their status, these two communities were at one time endeavoring to adopt some of the ways and habits of the Brahmins. The Sonars were styling themselves Daivadhya Brahmins and were wearing their dhotis with folds on and using the word namaskar for salutation. Both the folded wear of wearing the dhoti and the namaskar were special to the Brahmins. The Brahmins did not like this imitation and this attempt by Sonar to pass off as Brahmins. Under the authority of the Peshwas, the Brahmins successfully put down this attempt on the part of the Sonars to adopt the ways of the Brahmins. They even got the precedence of the councils of the East India Company settlement in Bombay to issue a prohibitory order against the Sonars residing in Bombay. At one time, the Pathari Prabhus had widow remarriage as a custom of the caste. This custom of widow remarriage was later on looked upon as a mark of social inferiority by some members of the caste, especially because it was contrary to the custom prevalent among the Brahmins. With the object of raising the status of the communities, some Pathari Prabhus sought to stop this practice of widow remarriage that was prevalent in the caste. The community was divided into two camps, one for and other against the innovation. The Peshwas took the side of those in favor of widow remarriage and thus virtually prohibited the Pathari Prabhus from following the ways of the Brahmins. The Hindus criticized the Mohammedans for having to spread the religion by the use of sword. They also ridiculed Christianity on the score of the Inquisition. But really speaking, who is better and more worthy of respect? The Mohammedans and the Christians who attempted to thrust down the throats of unwilling person what they regarded as necessary for their salvation, or the Hindu who would not spare the light, who would endeavor to keep the others in darkness, who would not consent to share his intellectual and social inheritance with those who are ready and willing to make it a part of their own makeup? I have no hesitation in saying that if the Mohammedan has been cruel, the Hindu has been mean, and meanness is worse than cruelty. Should I continue?
Shashank, go for the 10th section.
Okay. Whether the Hindu religion was or was not a missionary religion has been a controversial issue. Some hold a view that it was never a missionary religion. Others hold that it was. That the Hindu religion was once a missionary religion must be admitted. It could not have spread over the face of India if it was not a missionary religion. But today, it is not a missionary religion is also a fact which must be accepted. The question, therefore, is not whether or not the Hindu religion was the missionary religion. The real question is, why did the Hindu religion cease to be a missionary religion? My answer is this. The Hindu religion ceased to be a missionary religion when the caste system grew up among the Hindus. Caste is inconsistent with the conversion. Inculcation of beliefs and dogmas is not the only problem that is involved in conversion. To find a place for the convert in the social life of the community is another and a much more important problem than that arises in connection with conversion. That problem is where to place the convert and in what caste. It is a problem which must baffle every Hindu wishing to make aliens convert to his religion. Unlike the club, the membership of a caste is not open to all and study. The law of caste confines its membership to person born in the caste. Castes are autonomous, and there is no authority anywhere to compel a caste to admit a newcomer to its social life. Hindu society being a collection of castes, and each caste being a close corporation, there is no place for a convert. Thus, it is a caste which has prevented Hindus from expanding and from absorbing other religious communities. So long as castes remain, Hindu religion cannot be made a mystery religion, and Shuddhi will be both a folly and futility.
I think we can wait here for a while and maybe look at if there are any comments by anybody. I think, you know, this part is a continuation of the argument that a lot of people were making in favor of the caste system. And Baba Saheb Ambedkar is demolishing their arguments again and again through, you know, looking at the arguments of the opponents, whether political reform first, economic reform first, and so on and so forth. And Baba Saheb Ambedkar is putting up a case as to how the annihilation of caste is so important, as to why the caste are not in favor of the humanity, and so on and so forth. I think this particular section tells us that the Hindus lack that kind of a humanitarian spirit, because within them they are so much within them there is so much hate, as we can say in the case of the Sonars in Maharashtra and the Patharian Prabhus in Maharashtra, as to how they were denied even the basic modes of living, like what kind of a dhoti they should wear, what kind of how they should greet. Even those things were controlled. And this is also the case with Pathare Prabhus, that their attempt to change their social construct, social custom was halted. So it's very important. And at the end, Baba Saheb Ambedkar questions very rightly that people say that the Muslims are cruel, but what about the Hindus? The Hindus, according to Baba Saheb Ambedkar, they are mean, and meanness is worse than cruelty. Because in the cruelty, you can slay the person, you can kill the person, and you know, like that. But in the meanness, you keep on killing the people generation after generation. You know, like, if you look at the way the Hindu caste order is designed, it is so cruel that the generations after generations, even those who are not born today, they will be affected by this very violent, very mean mechanism of putting people down in the pigeonholes of caste. So I think this sentence is very important, that Hindus has been mean, and meanness is worse than cruelty. So then Baba Saheb Ambedkar also talks about how Hinduism has now ceased to become a missionary religion. So missionary religion is something which tries to seek for the adherence for its faith. But in case of Hindus, it has become very difficult to seek the people in their fold. And that's why we see today that they have come up with this lot of different ideas like ISKCON, art of living, you know. So I think this is a very contemporary sort of way to look at what Baba Saheb Ambedkar is discussing. Like, we know what, you know, the way ISKCON is being propagated, what kind of a doctrine, what kind of a conversion therein. So I think these are very important points that Baba Saheb Ambedkar is making. And I think some of you might like to comment on this.
So Uma here, I was... Yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, and I was thinking there was this new movement started by... Well, RSS, this whole Garvapsi, convert back into Hinduism. I think the same thing continues today. It's a total failure, because the situation remains the same, is what I'm trying to say.
That's a very good contemporary reflection, Garvapsi, Umaji, very good reflection.
I think it's more political, this movement. This was more political. This Ghar Vapsi was actually started by the RS Majis. And I think Dayanand Saraswati was the pioneer, and the main reason why he started this was to bring back especially our people who were converting to Christianity and Islam at that time. So, and they started, they were against this Arya Samajis, they were against the idol worship which the other Hindus were, and they believed in the infallibility of Vedas. Basically, this movement was to, bring back our people to Hinduism from Christianity and other religions, monotheistic religions. So still today it's a more a political gimmick, because they're losing their vote banks, actually. It's more a political gimmick.
Good point, Amrita.
I was reminded of a recent conversation on the group about, I think you had posted on Facebook about the people on the committee of the Ram temple, how of the 15, 14 are upper caste people and there's no representation for OBC, SC, ST. And somebody commented on the group that if we bring it up, they'll bring a Dalit priest and shut everyone's mouth. Somebody had commented on the group. This is that example of meanness.
Yeah.
Our president is the best example.
Yeah.
I think these sections now, which are running up to a few sections forward. They are all to show how the caste system has been a kind of a bane for the people, bane for the lower caste, and how it has affected and how it cannot really, create a humanitarian society. I think that was the argument that Baba Saheb Ambedkar started, that whatever humanitarian spirit is there among the Hindus, it's limited to their caste. So, that is what Baba Saheb Ambedkar is trying to prove here, as to how the caste kills the humanitarian spirit among the people. I think if there are no more comments, should we go forward?
Yes.
Okay. Shashank sir, continue.
Yep. Section 11. The reasons which have made Shuddhi impossible for Hindus are also responsible for making Sankatan impossible. The idea underlying Sangathan is to remove from the mind of the Hindu that timidity and cowardice which so painfully make him off from the Mohammedans and the Sikh, which have led him to adopt the low ways of treachery and cunning for protecting himself. The question naturally arises, from where does the Sikh or the Mohammedans derive his strength, which makes him brave and fearless? I'm sure it is not due to relative superiority of physical strain, diet, or drill. It is due to the strain arising out of the feeling that all Sikhs will come to the rescue of a Sikh when he is in danger, and that all Mohammedans will rush to save a Muslim if he is attacked. The Hindu can derive no such strain. He cannot feel assured that his fellows will come to his help. Being one and fated to be alone, he remains powerless, develops timidity and cowardice, and in a fight surrenders or runs away. The Sikh as well as the Muslim stands fearless and gives battle because he knows that though one, he will not be alone. The presence of this belief in the one helps him to hold out, and absence of it in the other makes him to give away. If you pursue this matter further and ask, what is it that enables the Sikh and the Mohammedans to feel so assured, and why is the Hindu filled with such despair in the matter of help and assistance? You will find that the reason for this difference lies in the difference in the associated mode of living. The associated mode of life practiced by the Sikhs and the Mohammedans produces fellow feeling. The associated mode of life of the Hindus does not. Among Sikhs and Muslims, there is a social cement which makes them bhais. Among Hindus, there is no such cement, and one Hindu does not regard another Hindu as his bhai. This explains why a Sikh says and feels that one Sikh or one Khalsa is equal to 7 lakh men. This explains why one Mohammedan is equal to a crowd of Hindus. This difference is undoubtedly a difference due to caste. So long as a caste remains, there will be no Sangathan. And so long as there is no Sangathan, the Hindu will remain weak and meek. The Hindus claim to be a very tolerant people. In my opinion, this is a mistake. On many occasions, they can be intolerant. And if on some occasions they are tolerant, that is because they are too weak to oppose or too indifferent to oppose. This indifference of the Hindus has become so much part of their nature that a Hindu will quite meekly tolerate an insult as well as a wrong. You see amongst them, to use the words of Morris, the great reading down the little, the strong beating down the weak, the cruel man fearing not, the kind man daring not, and the wise man caring not. With the Hindu gods all forbearing, it is not difficult to imagine the pitiable condition of the wronged and the oppressed among the Hindus. Indifferentism is the worst kind of disease that can infect a people. Why is the Hindu so indifferent? In my opinion, this indifferentism is a result of the caste system, which has made Sangathan and cooperation, even for a good cause, impossible.
One more section.
Yeah. The assertion by the individual of his own opinions and belief, his own independence and interests as over against group standards, group authority and group interest is the beginning of all reform. But whether the reform will continue depends upon what scope the group affords for such individual assertion. If the group is tolerant and fair-minded in dealing with such individuals, they will continue to assert and in the end, succeed in converting their fellows. On the other hand, if the group is intolerant and does not bother about the means it adopts to stifle such individuals, they will perish and the reform will die out. Now, a caste has an unquestioned right to excommunicate any man who is guilty of breaking the rules of the caste. And when it is realized that excommunication involves a complete cessation of social intercourse, it will be agreed that as a form of punishment, there is really little to choose between excommunication and death. No wonder individual Hindus have not had the courage to assert their independence by breaking the barriers of caste. It is true that men cannot get on with his fellows, but it is also true that he cannot do without them. He would like to have the society of his fellows on his terms. If we cannot get it on terms, then he will be ready to have it on any terms, even amounting to complete surrender. This is because he cannot do without society. A caste is ever ready to take advantage of the helplessness of a man and insist upon complete conformity to its code in letter and in spirit. A caste can easily organize itself into a conspiracy to make the life of a reformer a hell. And if a conspiracy is a crime, I do not understand why such a nefarious act as an attempt to excommunicate a person for daring to act contrary to the rules of caste should not be made an offense punishable in law. But as it is, even law gives each caste an autonomy to regulate its membership and punish dissenters with excommunication. Caste in the hands of orthodox has been a powerful weapon for prosecuting the reforms and for killing all reform.
Okay. Okay. I think these two paragraphs are so important that I think they can be as it is applied to the social organization or the social movements that we would like to build or our people are trying to build all over the country, that why the Muslims and the Sikhs, they 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 do not feel powerless because they have a sense of this community, the consciousness of kind. And but now when we look at the what has happened, that the Hindus or the Brahminical classes have become so smart that they have been able to mobilize the particularly the Adivasis and Dalits and the lower caste OBCs against the Muslim lot in terms of the Sangathan of the Hindutva people. So in this particular light, if we see the riots that are taking place in your country today or has been taking place since independence, and there is a Sikh riot of 1984, and there are a series of riots against the Muslims, I think we can think about this. But what makes the Hindus mobilize, I think, is a very important question in this light. It is Baba Saheb Ambedkar has elsewhere said that only against the Muslims that the caste get united, otherwise they don't get united. So this is a continuation of, you know, Sangathan. Sangathan means an organization, and you know how that organization cannot be built up. Even today, I think what Baba Saheb Ambedkar has said elsewhere is that the Hindu constitute a political majority by virtue of being a communal majority. But that communal majority is also fragmented by the caste differences, which Baba Saheb Ambedkar has spoken of many times. But I think this paragraph is very important from this perspective, that the Hindus have this kind of a worst kind of a disease of indifferentism. And indifferentism is the worst kind of disease that can infect a people. So I think this section 11 is pinpointing to a very important emotion that the caste system generates among the people, that it makes a people indifferent to other human beings. So one caste is only concerned with its own interest of its own caste people. But you know, there is an indifferentism for the other caste, and I think this is very remarkably attributed by Baba Saheb Ambedkar. That and we know that even when we work in the social movement, the feeling, the emotion like of indifferentism is ultimately leads to a great sort of weakening of the movement, because a lot of people are indifferent. For example, you know, there are caste atrocities, and even if they appear in media about the caste atrocity news appear in the media, but you see that people are generally indifferent unless you really do something to shock them about the brutality of the crime. But you see, you know, any sane human being reading the stories of atrocities, like, you know, recent atrocity that, you cannot call it atrocity, it's the worst kind of a crime that has been committed against the humanity, where the women's body was removed from the pile of the dead bodies. I think that she is from the untouchable background. Her body was removed and the rest of the bodies were burned. So we can see that this kind of indifferentism, even to the deads, is so much ingrained in the community, among the people, that it's nothing less than a disease. And it's the worst kind of a disease. So I think this paragraph is very important. And you know, the Shuddhi and Sangathan, they were the two motives of the Arya Samaja, as Amrita has just said, that they were the two strategies of Arya Samaj to bring the converted to Islam, converted to Christianity back into the fold of Aryans, because that time the Hindu identity was not so much solidified. You know, the Brahmins started with the identity of Aryan, started with Arya Samaj, and you know, initially they started with Brahmo Samaj and then Arya Samaj. And then we know that when the 20s came, and in 1915 the Hindu Mahasabha was registered, and 1925 RSS was registered. So we can see how this transformation of the identities have taken place, and now they are using this whole, you know, people who are not ready to accept Hindu identity. Even in Punjab, Adi Dravida, Adi. So people who are not accepting this even the in one of the censuses, they declared that they are not Hindus, Kabirpanthi. So we can see that, you know, there is this kind of a hodgepodge and the creation of the identity by the dominant forces of the time, particularly the so-called Brahminical forces. So I think this paragraph has to be seen in this historical light, that they are all talks about Sangathan, they are all talks about Shuddhi is futile because of the inherent caste bias among the minds of the people. Yes.
So what can be done to remove this indifferentism? And in my opinion, in present scenario, scheduled caste people are indifferent. You see, in other communities, if something happens, then people run to the help of the victims. And in scheduled caste, people still are indifferent. They are afraid. They don't go to help the victims and never fight. This is quite indifference is quite more seen more in scheduled caste people, I think, compared to other caste people like OBC. They go to help their community people, Tata, Brahmins, but this is particularly not seen in our this community.
Yeah.
This is not a case actually. The thing is like that, Hindus are Brahmins, what they are doing these days, they are mobilizing people in the name of Ram, in the name of Hindutva, and they are using them, all SC, STs, OBCs, to demolish Babri Masjid, to kill a person in the name of a cow. That guy, they had done Gauhatya. And when we can see in the GNU there was a protest against Muslims and Jamia Islamia University, the guy named Pandey, Harshit Pandey or what, I don't remember the exact name, he's firing openly and police is not stopping him. And a girl in Karnataka saying that Pakistan Zindabad, Hindustan Zindabad, she become terrorist. So the ideology of people, Brahmins are changing the ideology of people who will say Jai Shri Ram, he is a nationalist. And who condemns the Ram, he is anti-nation, he is terrorist. The things is like going that way. And even in OBCs also, they are diverted in the name of Hindutva. This is my opinion. And when it comes to the functions, I have read the book of Bhavar Meghwanshi, I couldn't be Hindu. How actually it get affected, that when he invited Brahmins to his home for having a dinner, so they didn't have dinner. They took the tiffin from him and threw it away in the road, and they had in another village. So this is the mentality. They in front of you, they are saying that they are patting you. They are saying that we are with you. They will use you for demolishing Babri Masjid, for the lathi charge of police. They will use you for the protest, but they will not support when it comes to them.
You are talking about mentality of the Brahmins. I was talking about mentality, indifference of our people.
Actually, in also in OBCs also, there are a lot of movement is going on that they should leave Hindu religion and all. So we can't say that OBC is also are not helping each other. Here in the case of Chhattisgarh also, I have seen that OBCs, and because Brahmins are still dividing the society in the name of Hindutva, in the name of Ram, that no OBC will help another OBC. No ST will help other OBST. They will work from Brahmin, but they will not ever, they will come, they will not get united for themselves. That's why we are facing this kind of problem.
I think maybe because we are not, no? very bold enough to generate and when the atrocities occur. Maybe we are in where we are not bold enough. And when we are in a position of vulnerability, not able to really assert ourselves, that could be one reason. If you are not reacting to such thing, and maybe definitely there is, and when we are in a position of vulnerability, we are not able to assert different. I mean, we are also divided around many issues. Like last time, we were really.
I think one of the meanings.
Can I add something?
One of the reasons, seeing we put the subcast.
Yes, please. Yes.
Shall I speak?
Yes, ma'am.
I think the reason why we people are not united is we don't have any solid culture to hold on to. Like Hindus, the upper caste people have, or the other monotheistic religions they have. They have a very, you know, solid culture. We don't have any one Bahujan culture to hold on to. And we are actually scared to accept another culture in the form of Buddhism, in the form of another religion.
Good point. I think the one of the meanings of the word indifferentism is not able to take a stand. So most of the time, most of the times people are not able to take the stand, and that is, I think, very, very much important characteristic of the Hindu religion, that even you know, this if one community is attacked, even it is prevalent among the scheduled caste, because you know, you see in the villages where people live fragmented into different castes. So when one caste is attacked, you know, the other caste, you know, the, in the similar circumstances should come to the rescue of it, isn't it? So I think this is not able to take a stand for what is right is absent, and therefore the sense of justice is absent. I think not having the sense of justice is something very important, because as a human being, as we evolve, we have this very generous sense of justice. You know, the Hinduism kills that kind of a sense of justice and fairness, I would say, because it's an unfair system. So, you know, it's said that the experiments after experiments have proved that the human beings tend to become very fair. You know, they love justice. And even among the animals, it was found that, you know, the fairness and justice is very naturally endowed to some of the human species, including the human beings. And this sense of justice has brought human race where it is today. But if, when we look at the Hinduism, it's a regressive, it's not progressive form of a system. It is, I would say, anti-evolutionary. It's such a loss to the human race, I would say. It is such a threat to the human race. Now, if we leave that paragraph aside, I think the paragraph number, the section number 12 is, I think, one of the very critical passages of annihilation of caste. Because, you know, this directly, indirectly, Babasaheb Ambedkar talks about, you know, social death here. And social death, as we know, can be as painful as the physical death. Sometimes it can be more painful than the actual physical death. So when we talk about this social death in terms of the threat to excommunicate the communities, the individuals, I think it was such a mean device which was created by the Brahminical Hinduism that we cannot even think of much cruel system than this. You can kill the people for, you know, transgressing certain things, but you know, if you are causing them social death, and social death is not a small word that we are talking about here. And the caste cannot tolerate the assertion of by the individual of his own opinion and beliefs, his own independence and interest. So as if the individual is made slave to the group interest, to the group standards. And in other words, the individual becomes just a servant to the group interest. So his independence, her thoughts, doesn't matter. So I think these are very important points that Babasaheb Ambedkar has made, and this is so important a line: a caste is ever ready to take advantage of the helplessness of a man and insist upon complete conformity to its code in letter and spirit. This is a system that thrives on the helplessness of the people. Isn't it? Now look at this, the way the people are economically made dependent. So you have no other means to survive, you know, like, you know, the human scavengers, for example. What kind of other options the system has left for them? Or for the untouchables, what kind of other options are left for them? Nothing. And when the people become helpless, the caste system tries to take advantage of it. And I think this is very important. So in this particular circumstances, we have to think about a very important word called empowerment of an individual, empowerment of the caste groups, empowerment of the communities, so that they are not helpless. Many a times, for example, if some bright student commits suicide in any institution, what does it show? It shows the powerlessness of an individual, helplessness of an individual. Isn't it? When your all doors are shut, when you know that there is nowhere to go, what do? You become so helpless, so down, so powerless you feel that you have no other means than to destroy your own life. And I think this helplessness has to be worked out. It has to be worked out. And I think this is very important. I think this, when we read the Annihilation of Caste, we also have to read it in terms of our present movements, our present generations, our youths, you know, and you know how we can see this knowledge that Babasaheb Ambedkar has given us to empower our community. Now see this last line in this paragraph. Caste in the hands of the orthodox has been a powerful weapon. So caste is a powerful weapon. One of the definitions of the caste is a weapon. You know, Babasaheb Ambedkar defines one particular thing in many different ways. So here Babasaheb Ambedkar is calling caste as a political weapon for persecuting the reforms and for killing all reforms. Isn't it? So caste is not innocent. Whenever there is a caste system, it's not innocent. It comes up with the persecution. It comes up with the killing of all reforms. So, see, Babasaheb Ambedkar was arguing against the political reforms vis-a-vis social reforms. Babasaheb Ambedkar was arguing against the economic reforms vis-a-vis political reforms. Now, here in this paragraph, Babasaheb Ambedkar says that it kills all the reforms. So, no reform is possible. You want to have a new education policy, new trade policy, new agriculture policy, whatever policies you want to bring up. Unless you attack this monster, as Babasaheb Ambedkar said, it's up, down, front, back, left, right, everywhere. You face any direction. In India, you find this monster. Any comments?
Uma ma'am has raised the hand before.
Yeah,
Uma.
No, I typed. I thought this concept of karma as believed by the Hindu is also a major hurdle, you know, contributes to this indifference. It is, the belief is he is suffering because of his karma. If he does something, karma will take care. There is no brotherhood or sense of justice because everything is attributed to karma. And I just wanted to add that.
That's a fantastic point.
I wanted to add in this, there is a concept of Nark and Swarg. And if you do this thing, you will go to Nark. If you do this thing, you will go to Swarg. And there's a fear of Nark and Swarg is letting people to make them indifferent.
Yes, and that Nark and Swarg together with Dharma. My Dharma is according to my caste, right? What my duty is according to my caste. So if I step out of the caste, then I will go to hell. So, you know, there's too much bondage around feeling any human emotions for fellow brethren.
And there is a fear between fear for God, in the name of God. If you're not, there is a fear of God, and if you're not, you will go to Him. So that fear makes them not to deviate from their religion.
Mihir, sir?
Yes, also I agree with this point that the entire thing about karma and also the God, and I mean, it's not only in the, when we see in the household and in the private life, but it also affects, for example, the workplace and, you know, like offices which are running businesses right now also. Like, I have heard so many friends of mine who are working in like different kinds of private offices, and they are saying that, you know, there is no business. And like the boss comes out and says that, ha, like, sab kuch Bhagwan ke bhorose hai, you know. Nobody is ready to talk about how the economy is crumbling. Nobody is ready to talk about how GST and demonetization has affected like small scale businesses. Like any kind of, you know, calamity, if it comes, it is very strange. It gets attributed to these things like, ha, wo jiska naseeb mein likha hai, wo ho jayega. And like, this is coming from like the spaces which I have also been part of, like, you know, different kinds of professors or teachers or even like so-called you know, progressive business people and all stuff like that. So it is like a deep rot which has penetrated in absolutely all forms of life.
Good evening.
Yes.
May I say something, sir?
Yes, please, Rajesh.
Sir, good evening, everybody. Though I am new to this group, I joined few days back only. I belong to Himachal. So nice to hear all of you. You are doing wonderful job. I just joined and I came to the conclusion that we keep on talking of all these things because we as a society were the people, those who were deprived of each and everything, and the reason was made for the benefit of particular community. And the diversion was like this, that the everything is siphoned out of each and every person of the society and goes towards one end. And that's why the people, they were struggling for their meal. They never had any time to talk of liberty or anything else. So now things are evolving day by day, and the dedication which is being shown by the people, the younger generation particularly, I think the things will improve. And let's stop talking what happened in the past. Come forward and find out means how we can change our society.
Good point, Ajay. Good point.
Yes, can I make a point?
Yeah.
See, Baba Saab rightly envisaged the reason why we people are not united. That was, the reason is the mental slavery that we all have. And the reason of the slavery is that we believe in the fear of unknown. You know, there is a fear of that unknown super being or I think religion or the religious philosophy, which counteracts the irrationalities, you know, which are being propagated by all religions, Hinduism or even other monotheistic religions. Because all the religions, they focus on a man's attempt to please his God in whichever form. You know, what the relation between them, what should be the relation between a man to man? No religion, you know, it lays stress on this point. So I think this is the main reason of a mental slavery. And the only solution we have is that we should adopt Buddhism. The rationalities of Buddhism, I mean.
Welcome to Bhavani Sahab from Himachal Pradesh. It's lovely to have you. And you know, we are going on reading these things. I think this particular reading, what we are doing in terms of this annihilation of caste. Now, I think the more important passages are yet to come, where we can talk about the very important ways out that Baba Ambedkar has given. If you do not have any emergent comment on your mind, can we move on to reading further?
Yes.
Okay. Rahul, please continue.
Yes. Good evening and Jai Bhim to all. Section 13. The effect of caste on the ethics of the Hindus is simply deplorable. Caste has killed public spirit. Caste has destroyed the sense of public charity. Caste has made public opinion impossible. A Hindu's public is his caste. His responsibility is only to his caste. His loyalty is restricted only to his caste. Virtue has become caste-ridden, and morality has become caste-bound. There is no sympathy to the deserving. There is no appreciation of the meritorious. There is no charity for the needy. Suffering as such call for no response. There is a charity, but it begins with the caste and ends with the caste. There is a sympathy, but not for man of other caste. Would a Hindu acknowledge and follow the leadership of a great and good man? The case of Mahatma apart, the answer must be that he will follow a leader if he is a man of his caste. A Brahmin will follow a leader only if he is a Brahmin, a Kayastha if he is a Kayastha, and so on. The capacity of appreciate merits in a man apart from his caste does not exist in a Hindu. There is an appreciation of virtue, but only when the man is fellow caste man. The whole morality is as bad as tribal morality. My caste man right or wrong, my caste man good or bad, it is not a case of standing by virtue and not standing by voice. It is a case of standing or not standing by the caste. Have not Hindus committed treason against their country in the interest of their caste? Section 14. I would not be surprised if some of you have grown weary listening to this tiresome tale of the sad effects which caste has produced. There is nothing new in it. I will therefore turn to the constructive side of the problem. What is your ideal society if you do not want caste is a question that is bound to be asked of you. If you ask me, my ideal would be society based on liberty, equality, and fraternity. And why not? What objection can there be to a fraternity? I cannot imagine any. An ideal society should be mobile, should be full of channels for conveying a changing taking place in one part to other parts. In any ideal society, there should be many interests consciously communicated and shared. There should be varied and free points of contact with other modes of association. In other words, there must be social endosmosis. This is fraternity, which is only another name of democracy. Democracy is not merely a form of government. It is a primarily mode of associated living of conjoined communicated experience. It is essentially an attitude of respect, a reverence towards Philemon. Any objection to liberty? Few people to liberty in the sense of right to free movement, in the sense of right to life and limb. There is no objection to liberty in the sense of right to properly tools and material as being necessary for earning a living to keep the body in due state of health. Why not allow liberty to benefit of an effective and competent use of person's power? The supporters of caste who would allow liberty in the sense of right to life, limb and property would not readily consent to liberty in this sense, in as much as it involves liberty to choose one's profession. But to object to the kind of liberty is so perpetuate slavery. For slavery does not merely mean a legalized form of subjection. It means a state of society in which some men are forced to accept from others the purpose which control their conduct. The condition obtained even when where there is no slavery in the legal sense. It is found where in the caste system. Some persons are compelled to carry a certain prescribed callings which are not of their choice. Any objection to equality? This has obviously been the most contentious part of the slogan of the French Revolution. The objections to equality may be sound, and one may have to admit that all men are not equal. But what of that? Equality may be a fiction, but nonetheless one must accept it as the governing principle. A man's power is dependent upon, first, physical heredity, second, social inheritance or endowment in the form of parental care, education, accumulation of scientific knowledge, everything which enables him to be more efficient than the savage, and finally, third, on his own efforts. In all these three respects, men are undoubtedly unequal. But the question is, shall we treat them as unequal because they are unequal? This is a question which opponents of equality must answer. From the standpoint of the individualist, it may be just to treat men unequally so far as their efforts are unequal. It may be desirable to give as much incentive as possible to the full development of everyone's power. But what would happen if men were treated unequally as they are? In the first two respects, it is obvious that those individuals also in whose favor there is birth, education, family name, business connection, and inherited wealth will be selected in the race. But selection under such circumstances would be not be a selection of the able. It will be the selection of the privileged. The reason, therefore, which forces that in the third respect, we should treat man unequally demands than in the first two respect, we should treat man as equally as possible. On the other hand, it can be urged that if it is good for the social body to get the most out of its members, it can get most out of them only by making them equal as far as possible at the very start of the race. That is the one reason why we cannot escape equality. But there is another reason why we must accept equality. A statesman is concerned with vast number of people. He has neither the time nor the knowledge to draw fine distinctions and to treat each equitably. That is according to need for according to capacity. However, desirable or reasonable or equitable treatment of man may be. Humanity is not capable of assortment and classification. The statesman therefore must follow some rough and ready rule, and the rough and ready rule is to treat all men alike, not because they are alike, because classification and assortment is impossible. The doctrine of equality is glaringly fallacious, but taking all in all is the only way a statesman can proceed in politics, which is severely practical affair and which demands a severely practical test.
So we wait here, because now after describing this evils of the caste system, Baba Ambedkar has now here described what kind of an ideal society that he would like to see. And I think this is a paragraph which condenses his ideal of society. And this paragraph is so important that we have to reflect on it very much, because these key concepts that we see, fraternity, liberty, and equality, they are so important in the Ambedkarite mode of thinking, that we have to look at different meanings that Baba Saheb Ambedkar has given here. It's in 1936, before the constitution was written. And Baba Saheb Ambedkar is talking about his values of liberty, equality and fraternity, that word. The beginning of the passage is taken from the democracy and education, which Baba Saheb Ambedkar likes so much, from his teacher, John Dewey. And it's like verbatim he has quoted. So what is fraternity, which is only another name of democracy? And I think these are very important sentences that in themselves, they will need a lot of analysis and a lot of unpacking, because here every single word matters. And this is so important for all of us too, when we think about a community, when we think about a fraternity. It is not just respect and reverence towards each other, but it goes on communicating the changes, you know, creating multiple points of contacts between the people. Now, like this, our virtual reading group is also one of the points of contacts for the communities. And there can be many points of contact for the communities, you know, throughout our country. Also, the very important conjoined communicated experience. These are so important words that, you know, when we think about the fraternity, Baba Saheb Ambedkar has used so many ways to define what is a fraternity. So it is not just a sloganeering, because most of the time, liberty, equality and fraternity is reduced to the slogans. But when we look at this, these are not slogans. This is a practical way by which the fraternity can come alive. So I think this is a very important discussion that Baba Saheb Ambedkar is having here on the notion of fraternity. And I think the passages on liberty is so clear that, you know, other people cannot decide for us the purpose of our living. And that is what exactly the caste system does. For many people, it defines the purpose of their lives in terms of other people. For example, upper caste, people decide the purpose of your life, isn't it? And that is worse than the slavery, because you are enslaved by the virtue of changing the purpose of your own life, so that you are only serviceable to the interest of the other people. And I think this is very important, because this passage is so liberating for us, that when we talk about the Buddha, the Atta Deepa Bhava, means be your own light. We cannot live in the light of other people. So here the passage says that we cannot live our life for the purposes, you know, put in our minds by the other people. Isn't it? I think this is a very important paragraph that we find in this particular section. And then equality, the discussion of equality. So, you know, numerical equality, you know, is like one person is equal to another person. No, it's not possible that one person is equal to another person. But the fact is every human being is unique. Now, in this group where we are reading it, each one of us is unique. Okay. There is no
other person.
There is nobody like us. Okay. We are all individuals and all unique. And there is no way by which the human being is capable of classifying the people. So, for example, you know, there are different ways of classifying the people based on nationality. Now, you say Indian, Pakistani or American, whatever, based on nationality. Now, that is one way. It doesn't capture that, you know, that one Indian equal to, you know, as opposed to Pakistani. It's the arbitrarily classification. So there is no human, you know, there is no human power to classify people into watertight compartments. It's very deep insight that Baba Saheb Ambedkar has given us, that human being cannot be classified and assorted in different boxes. And whatever the assortments are there, they are all man-made. They are not biologically done. It is not possible to biologically classify people into different classes like caste or, you know, race, or, you know, inferior or superior. There is no way by which this assortment can be done. For the practical purposes, we can do. For example, for the implementation of the reservation policy, we can classify some people as having social educational backwardness. But that doesn't mean that, you know, the individuals are, you know, backward or, you know, socially backward from their birth. And this way of looking at the problem, you know, physical hereditary, social inheritance. Because, you know, when people are racing, not everybody is on the same line. Like, for example, the urban upper caste youth has certain more advantages than the rural scheduled caste boy or a girl by the virtue of this thing. So we cannot treat them equally because they are not equal. So we have to have the unequal treatment for them. Elsewhere, Baba Ambedkar says that, you know, because the people are not equal, we have to have unequal treatment. You understand this paradox in a sentence? So I think this is a very important passage that we have to look into, and you know, let's discuss about it.
To establish a fraternity, there should be common activity, communication among the people of the community, and finally, Baba Sahib says that there must be social endosmosis to establish fraternity.
Alka ma'am, can you please explain what is endosmosis? Osmosis?
That is basically, I don't know, but I think emotions should be infiltrated from upside to downside till the last person of the society.
Alka ma'am, I think this concept of this metaphor of osmosis, where the caste doesn't create that kind of a permeable membrane between the communities. So there is no osmosis between the groups because the caste create a very thick cell wall around that particular group. There is no exchange between the groups. So I think by social endosmosis is a free flow, that the wall is not, opaque. It's transparent. The material can be exchanged within and without. So for example, when we talk about what is not social endosmosis, is we can take the case of endogamy, you know, where the blood relation between the different castes is not possible. So I think, you know, the social was a very beautiful concept. And you know, when the caste gets locked, enclosed into a group, because Baba Saheb Ambedkar also says that the caste is an enclosed class, isn't it? So I think this concept of endosmosis is so important that every caste has to become fluid. Its cell wall should become permeable so that the endosmosis takes place. For example, if there are people in Punjab, there are people in Maharashtra, people in South, if they get caught up, you know, enclosed into a class without any permeation from the outside, that is not fraternity. It's a very deep concept of fraternity, I think Baba Saheb Ambedkar has given us.
Yes.
I think the caste system, the walls that the caste system has built, they're made of concrete, they're not permeable. That is what Baba Saheb wants to say. There's no fusion, matlab. You cannot make out ki andar kya ho raha hai dusri caste mein. They cannot make out what you are doing culturally or religiously or otherwise. There's no permeability. The walls are made of concrete. They're not permeable.
Yeah. But the question for us, Amritpal ji, as to how we at least break walls between us, within our communities.
that is what we are doing right now. This is called permeability.
Yeah.
I think we should let our cultures merge, you know. Because we people have different cultures, we don't have one culture, so we should merge to make one culture.
One say, I never faced any caste discrimination. Being an engineering student, being a good student also, till my graduation, I never faced any caste discrimination. I had an attitude, being a cricket player of the Ranji level. Nobody dare me to ask caste and the consequences. But this has broken now and by our community people because of social isolation. Once you do something, what is the caste system? So, you know, these are really what Mangesh said. These are just the big concepts, fraternity, equality, liberty, unless it is practiced. So the practice has to be from us first. You know, a 38-year experience, I am saying that the caste system, the sufferance of caste system I got from our community first. This is a big statement. You know, this has to be practiced by ourselves first. Then only we can talk of breaking it.
Can I say, sir, something?
Yes,
hello,
please.
Hello, Jeffrey Mall. Am I audible to all?
Yes, Rucha, ma'am.
Yeah. So the concept of liberty, fraternity, and equality, to reach it to the common people, I think so we must focus on what the community needs. Like what the common people. Here in VRG group, we are reading, I can see 34 participants are there. But when we are in community, their needs are different. What they need? If suppose last time, Shirisha ma'am has raised the question of forming event calendar. So that this is a common platform, the common people can come, gather, and then we provide them what they like. Like, do they like painting? Do they like singing songs, etc.? All such activities. And then we can communicate our message to them. What needs to be done? Actually, what Babasaheb asked us to do. Slowly, slowly, we can change that. But it will not, come in clicks. The concept, the bookish concept, we can say. But what is practical, we need. Even though they are small things, but what community likes, what everyone gets us together in one platform, bringing them in one platform is a big challenge. Organize people is a big challenge. So I think so we need to focus on that. Thank you.
Good points, Rucha ma'am. Very good points.
I think one adding to the Rucha's point and getting back to the concept of practically following this big concept of social endosmosis, I can really want to reiterate again the point, while working on the project of Manu Madness, given by Mangesh sir, it was people from different background, Uma ma'am from different background, Rucha different background. And Prashant, he is from, he's a scientist from ISRO, completely different. And coming together collectively to work on this project of Manu Madness, I think within those 10 or 12 days, we really feel so much, permeated with each other. That form of a feeling of fellow friendship we feel, and we feel so much connected towards each other, every day, every hour, getting updates, how we are feeling, what are our emotions, we're capturing this text of Manu Madness. And we become pretty good friends, I can say. And I think within those 10 or 12 days, I can say that, yes, I really experienced that social endosmosis, really experienced the feeling of fraternity and the feeling of equality. Because I think that, in that group, the three actively women and three actively men were balancing also the gender barrier as well. So there was no such more men or more women. So it was a wonderful experience. So yes, I can say that, such kind of projects of Ambedkarite projects definitely bring this experience of social endosmosis, and we can connect a lot of people from different backgrounds. So it was a wonderful experience to experience that.
Very good. Thank you for sharing, Shashank.
I think the can I say a point? Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah.
I think this has really made social endorsements more possible, because initially we are all disconnected. Now we even talk to the And project of, I think, one another matrimonial site will also help in this social endorsement. And definitely, as you say, after coming to joining IADF in Madrid, our project of, I think, met so many people, I mean, more than what I did in the college. So that is also, it's all an ongoing process of endosmosis, and it definitely help us to unite. And Dr. Amrit Prasad, I think there should be some unity in diversity. It's not that we all should have the same thoughts. Diversity will really unite us better. Being a South and being North, that sometimes bond is better. Because familiarity breeds contempt sometimes. Anyway, that's my opinion. But diversity really unites us better. That's my point, I would take.
Beautiful. One of the things that I would like to comment here is, you know, like some text demands slow reading. Some text demand fast reading. And sometimes the reading, the speed matters, because now as we are reading the Sanitation of Caste, we are very slow in reading. And I think it's very important to do the slow reading so that we let these concepts digest. Because they are so important concepts that we have to really have this very slow, very careful reading of the text. So, you know, even I think even if we are not advancing, like we have advanced in terms of other books very fast, because, you know, those books were very important, but sometimes they didn't demand the slow reading that this Annihilation of Caste is forcing us to do it. See, every speech, every book is a lazy machine in the philosophy, in the language philosophy. It's called the lazy machine. And who makes that lazy machine work is the reader, isn't it? So now, as we are reading the Annihilation of Caste, it's just a, you know, words and book, you know, written on a page. Now, when we're reading it, this is a lazy machine, and we are making it alive. We are kicking it. We are, you know, changing one nut here. You know, not changing, but, you know, looking at different organs of this machine and trying to make sense of it, trying to understand it for ourselves. I think this is a very important process that we are going through. So I don't mind, you know, we are being slow reading this Annihilation of Caste, because I think this takes demands that kind of a slow, careful, attentive reading, because it's so I would say very important, and the text demands it. It forces us to read it slowly. Having said this, if there is nothing in this particular topic, I think this is like, now see, Baba Saheb Ambedkar has been building the arguments against the caste. Now he has written he has brought us to the apogee, the highest point. And now we are, you know, sort of, you will feel that. So, you know, he's building his argument. Now he's at the top. He's saying that, okay, this is completely wrong. The caste system is you know, is so wrong, is evil. Then he says, okay, this is my ideal. And now he has the ideal to compare with. And now he will show us how this caste is very incompatible with this ideal of liberty, equality, and fraternity. I think that's the students of rhetoric and the students of communication can really see the structure in this speech as to how Baba Saheb Ambedkar has really structured this speech. And there is a lesson for all of us. You know? Anuradha.
I wanted to add, please go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. This sentence, it really just, you know, popped out at me. Why have not Hindus committed treason against their own country in the interests of their caste? So lately I'm working on this paper. So in that I'm looking at the immigration of Brahmins to United States. So very surprisingly, the first early wave of immigration to United States by the upper caste was in 1965, when the immigration policy of the United States changed. And then they went in two or three more waves. The second wave was like 30,000 people per year, who were the family members of the people who had already gone. And there are some books which are hailing this, upper caste books, which are saying that why did this immigration happen? That's because we had a beautiful social system in place which made sure that we had all the right education, we had all the right social background, we had an urban background. So we were built to be in the United States. And because of this social background, which was built on the labor of our people, their they become allies of the white people because they did not go through the ghetto stage that the blacks and the Latin Americans went through, and then they clawed their way up. They struggled the way we are struggling. So, and then if we take this same argument further, we look at our liberalization policies, et cetera, we look at the board of directors of our companies, we see that around, the statistics are really damning, like 96% of the board of directors of thousands of companies in India are all upper caste, all Brahmins, all Vaishyas, some Syrian Christians, Parsis. So when we say, have not the Hindus committed treason against their own country in the interest of caste, there is so much evidence to prove that this statement holds true even today, that they continue to bleed this country, bleed us who are, you know, the labor class, the SCs, STs, the VJNTs, the OBCs, so who are the labor class. So the upper caste Hindus continue to, you know, commit treason against their own countrymen, all just to maintain their caste hegemony in every sphere. I just wanted to add that.
Beautiful point, Anuradha, and we are looking forward towards your full paper very soon.
There is no liberty for men to choose their own profession here, because of the the upper class want slavery. They have no right to choose the profession. So the people who are doing manual scavenging, they have to continue the same job like this. So there is no liberty for men to earn money in whatever the job they like. The object of this kind of liberty is to perpetuate slavery. Babasaheb is saying.
Okay, Sonika, I think we should go on reading further if there are not any immediate, urgent thoughts on somebody's mind, anybody's mind. Should we go on?
Okay, sir. Yeah, Sanjay Saman sir is with us. We will continue reading. Sanjay sir, please.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes. We are in 15th section, right?
Yeah.
But there is a set of reformers who hold out a different ideal. They go by the name of the Arya Samajis, and their ideal of social organization is what is called Chaturvarnya, or the division of society into four classes instead of the four class that we have in India. To make it more attractive and to disarm position, the protagonist of Chaturvarnya take great care to point out that their Chaturvarnya is based not on birth but on guna, worth. At the outset, I must confess that notwithstanding the worth basis of the Chaturvarnya, it is an ideal to which I cannot reconcile myself. In the first place, if under the Chaturvarnya of the Arya Samajist, an individual is to take his place in the Hindu society according to his worth, not by birth, I do not understand why the Arya Samajist insists upon labeling men as Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra. A learned man be honored without his being labeled a Brahmin. A soldier would be respected without his being designated a Kshatriya. If European society honors its soldiers and its servants without giving them permanent labels, why should Hindu society find it difficult to do so is a question which Arya Samajists have not cared to consider. There is another objection to the continuance of these labels. All reform consists in a change in the notions, sentiment, and mental attitudes of the people towards men and things. It is common experience that certain names become associated with certain notions and sentiments which determine a person's attitude towards men and things. The names Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra are names which are associated with a definite and fixed notion in the mind of every Hindu. That notion is that a hierarchy based on birth. So long as these names can continue, Hindus will continue to think of the Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra as hierarchy divisions of high and low based on birth and act accordingly. The Hindu must be made to unlearn all this, but how can this happen if the old labels remain and continue to recall to his mind old notions? If new notions are to be inculcated in the minds of people, it is necessary to give them new names. To continue the old name is to make the reform futile. To allow this, Chaturvarna, based on worth to be designated by such stinking labels of Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, indicative of social divisions based on birth, is a snare.
We will pause here for a minute or two before we read on. I think this this section covers a very important ground in terms of the names, because you know you will come to this argument again and again that the Chaturvarna is a division of labor. You know, some people are there to give guidance, there are some people to protect. So okay, fine. But if you only fix it before, you know, giving people responsibilities like Brahmin, I think this point is so important that the labels that are there in the society, like the Brahmin is called Pandit, even if he is the worst of a human being. So say, oh, Pandit is going, Pandit kaha ja rahe ho, okay. So Rajput will, you know, try to say that, you know, I am, you know, by the virtue of my aisa much rakhunga or whatever. So what I'm trying to get it at here is, you know, we have to understand one psychological thing here, that the words matter, the language matters. And the language that we speak are sometimes so loaded in favor of certain castes and loaded against certain people that we need new languages and new notions. Even in our movement, we need new language, new notions, not the old ones. Because the old ones will perpetuate the same kind of the patterns of the society that has been in continuation in the past, and they will go on spiraling up in the future as it is. And therefore, I think it is very important to have this very important discussion on labeling, the meaning of name. Because sometimes some names are so ignoble that people having those names, they feel so bad about themselves. Isn't it? So I think, you know, this, and it also ties up with the Buddha's concept of naming names and forms. You know, Buddha has given this very important concept of name and form, where the form is we can say things and the process of naming it. We all the time name it. This, that. This process of naming that goes on our minds all the time, which is called sadhna, all the time in our minds. We get always, you know, naming things, categorizing it according to our mental furniture and mental makeup. So I think, you know, we need these new ways, new notions to look at the things, isn't it? So one of the ways that Baba Saheb Ambedkar would argue that there is also, it's very important for our communities to also change the names, isn't it? To have names which will communicate, you know, who we are. And that's why, you know, there is a tradition where, you know, a lot of people in the north particularly, they have tried to put Gautam in front of their names, or Bodh in front of their names, and so on and so forth. Like, there can be beautiful names from the past that we can take, or, you know, new names also we can take. So I think this is very important. And I didn't want to go into this there, but you know, this Gita has been brought in as the kind of remodeling of the Sankhya philosophy of a theory of guna, that you know there are guna, and you know people are based on their worth, not based on their birth. But you know, a priori you have a caste system, so how can you have anything based on the worth unless you demolish that, isn't it? Because a priori you have a system where you know you have Brahmins, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudras a priori, and you are saying that now it will be based on the birth. There is a system based on the birth, and now you are saying based on the worth. So this is very contradictory. One has to go, isn't it? So what has to go is the old system of naming. The old system has to go before, you know, new Chaturvarna. If say, for example, we argue that Chaturvarna is a good form of organizing society, what we would say? We would say, okay, destroy this now and let's have the new Chaturvarna, where the you know, like the way Baba Ambedkar said when he met Gandhi, you know, there is this famous dialogue between, you know, this very beautiful hand gesture where Gandhi argues that he believes in Chaturvarna. So Baba Sahib says, you believe in this kind of a Chaturvarna or this kind of a Chaturvarna? And then Kanchiram Sahib has gone ahead and said this kind of a Chaturvarna. You see the beautiful hand gesture, isn't it? So, you know, we want Brahmins at top and, you know, other people at bottom, or you want horizontal one. This is what Baba Ambedkar said. Then Kanchiram ji said that if the worst comes to worst, we can have it like this.
Right.
Isn't it? So, I think
birth should not be taken into consideration. Worth should be considered first. This was the aim of Baba Sahib.
Annihilation of caste.
So, if there is no other comment from your side, we can move on to reading 16th section. But Anuradha wanted
names
to
in Mangesh, names in our country, they represent the religious identity. Even if we leave Hinduism, we got the religion, like for example Sikhism, their names are no doubt different, but you know, by through from the name you can understand then, you know, that this person is either a Muslim or a, so I mean this is a religious identity. Naming or changing our names will, I think, not serve much purpose until and unless this notion is changed. The religious notion is changed.
Yeah, in your case, it might be different. But in Maharashtra, some of the names that you see and some of the surnames that you see, they are so horrible. You know, that I think, you know, in those cases, the names...
No, definitely in Hinduism, I agree. Yes, our people have very disrespectful names. But if you talk about India as a country, you know, because there are many other religions also.
Yeah.
Hinduism, definitely we need to change our names. But when you see other religions, I think their names are certainly better.
Yeah. I agree. Anuradha, you wanted to say something?
I think Sanjay sir wants to say something. Sanjay sir?
Yeah. I'm audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you for joining, getting me in this group. I'm from Saudi Arabia. Regarding these names, I'm fully agree that names makes a difference in our society. So recently, I heard that Maharashtra government, when Uddhav Thackeray came into power, he initiated one movement to change the names of the region and Chowk Square or residential area, which suggests the caste. But unfortunately, he could not progress because of the emergence of pandemic. So this was the good movement by the government recently. Oh, over.
Yeah. So should we go on reading further, Sanjay bhai?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, I'm ready. Hello?
Yes, sir. Please start, sir.
Sonika, please.
Yes,
please.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Section 16. To me, this Chaturvarna with its old labels is utterly repellent, and my whole being rebels against it. But I don't wish to rest of my objection to Chaturvarna on mere grounds of sentiments. There are more solid grounds on which I rely for my oppositions to it. A close examination of this ideal has convinced me that as a system of social organization, Chaturvarna is impracticable, harmful, and has turned out to be a miserable failure. From a practical point of view, the system of Chaturvarna raises several difficulties, which its protagonists do not seem to have taken into account. The principle underlying caste is fundamentally different from the principle underlying Varna. Not only are they fundamentally different, but they are also fundamentally opposed. The former is based on worth. How are you going to compel people who have acquired a higher status based on birth without reference to their worth to vacate that status? How are you going to compel people to recognize the status due a man in accordance with his worth, who is occupying a lower status based on his birth? For this, you must first break up the caste system in order to be able to establish the Varna system. Next, please. How are you going to reduce the 4,000 castes based on birth to the four Varnas based on worth? This is the first difficulty which the protagonist of the Chaturvarna must grapple with. There is a second difficulty which the protagonist of Chaturvarna must grapple with. If they wish to make the establishment of Chaturvarna success, Chaturvarna presupposes that you can classify people into four definite classes. Is this possible? In this respect, the ideal of Chaturvarna has, as you will see, a close affinity to the Platonic ideal. To Plato, men fell by nature into three classes. In sub-individuals, he believed mere appetites now dominated. He assigned them to the laboring and trading classes. Others revealed to him that over and above appetites, they have a courageous disposition. He classed them as defenders in war and guardians of internal peace. Others showed a capacity to grasp the universal reason underlying things. He made them the lawgivers of the people. The criticism to which Plato's Republic is subject is also the criticism which must apply to the system of Chaturvarna. Insofar as it proceeds upon the possibility of an accurate classification of men into four distinct classes, the chief criticism against Plato is that his idea of lumping of individuals into a few sharply marked off classes is a very superficial view of man and his powers. Plato had no perception of the uniqueness of every individual, of his incommensurability with others, of each individual forming a class of his own. He had no recognition of the infinite diversity of active tendencies and combination of tendencies of which an individual is capable. To him, there were types. To him, there were types of faculties of powers in the individual constitution. All this is demonstrably wrong. Modern science has shown that lumping together of individuals into a few sharply marked off classes is a superficial view of man, not worthy of serious consideration. Consequently, the utilization of the qualities of individuals is incompatible with their stratification by classes, since the qualities of individuals are so variable. Chaturvarna must fail for the very reason for which Plato's Republic must fail, namely that it is not possible to pigeon men into holes. According as he belongs to one class or the other, that is that it is impossible to accurately classify people into four definite classes is proved by the fact that the original four classes have now become 4,000 castes. There is a third difficulty in the way of the establishment of the system of Chaturvarna. How are you going to maintain the system of Chaturvarna? Supposing it was established, one important requirement for the successful working of Chaturvarna is the maintenance of the penal system, which could maintain it by its sanction. The system of Chaturvarna must perpetually face the problem of the transgressor. Unless there is a penalty attached to the act of transgression, men will not keep to their respective classes. The whole system will break down. Being contrary to human nature, Chaturvarna cannot subsist by its own inherent goodness. It must be enforced by law. That without penal sanction, the ideal of Chaturvarna cannot be realized is proved by the story of the in the Ramayana of Rama killing Shambhuka. Some people seem to blame Rama because he wantonly and without reason killed Shambhuka. But to blame Rama for killing Shambhuka is to misunderstand the whole situation. Ram Raj was a Raj based on Chaturvarna. As a king, Rama was born to maintain Chaturvarna. It was his duty, therefore, to kill Shambhuka, the Shudra who had transgressed his class and wanted to be a Brahmin. This is the reason why Rama killed Shambhuka. But this also shows that penal action is necessary for the maintenance of Chaturvarna. Not only penal sanction is necessary, but penalty of death is necessary. That is why Rama did not inflict on Shambhuka a lesser punishment. That is why Manusmriti prescribes such heavy sentences as cutting off the tongue or pouring off molten lead in the ears of the Shudra who recites or hears the Veda. The supporters of Chaturvarna must give an assurance that they could successfully classify men and they could induce modern society in the 20th century to reforge the penal sanctions of Manusmriti. The protagonists of Chaturvarna do not seem to have considered what is the happened to women in their system. Are they also to be divided into four classes, Brahmin, Kshatri, Vaishya and Shudra? Or are they to be allowed to take the status of their husbands? If the status of the woman is to be the consequences of marriage, what becomes of the underlying principle of Chaturvarna, namely that the status of a person should be based upon the worth of that person? If they are to be classified according to their worth, as their classification to be nominal or real? If it is to be nominal, then it is useless, and then the protagonist of Chaturvarna must admit that their system doesn't apply to women. If it is real, Chaturvarna are the protagonist of Chaturvarna prepared to follow the logical consequences of applying to it to women? They must be prepared to have women priests and women soldiers. Hindu society has grown accustomed to women teachers and women barristers. It may grow accustomed to women brewers and women butchers, but he would be a bold person who would say that it will allow women priests and women soldiers, but that will be the logical outcome of applying Chaturvarna to women. Given these difficulties, I think no one except a conscientious idiot could hope and believe in a successful regeneration of the Chaturvarna. I think we should discuss and go ahead, or
we should discuss, because you know this paragraph is so important that we need to discuss it fully, because this this has so many important concepts that are so important in terms of understanding. You know, there are this very weighty concepts here, like commensurability, like whether one human being can be measured against another human being. Because what is a human being is a very important question, and what kind of a tendencies the human beings have, and the combination of those tendencies, no one has any idea about it, isn't it? So this Platonic Republic, the book that is often talked about in terms of Plato's idea of a republic, where he has these three classes of people, and Baba Saheb Ambedkar is completely opposed to these Platonic ideas, where you classify people into watertight, marked off compartments. And I think this discussion is so important for us to think about an individual, because a man or a human being is a class in his own, because we all are endowed with so many different tendencies, and they are so varied in each human being, and the combination of that we cannot even think about. You know, you look at human brain, you know, there are doctors among us, they will be able to tell us the capabilities of the brain that we have, the plasticity of the brains we have, the kind of the kind of powers that an individual has is so important that, you know, there we cannot be classed into very sharp classes, because we are class within ourselves. Every individual is a class. And this is such a fascinating thing, that there is no scale which can measure one human being against another human being. And if that classification has to come, it has to be enforced by force, like Manusmriti, by creating the penal codes for transgressing the one class that, you know, you are artificially put into. So, you know, this discussion also tells us that the caste is an artificial construct. It can never be a biological construct. It can never be the universal construct. So I think this focus on an individual in terms of their innate capacities, in terms of their faculties, cannot be marked into any class. There is no ground by which we can lump the individual humans together. Isn't it? So I think, you know, this is a very important paragraph that we have to think about. And as Sungar brother has put it, he has brought one word out, congenital idiot. You know, there has to be, you know, I think this annihilation of caste demands the dictionary of idioms in itself. I think, you know, there are so many beautiful words here. That, you know, one of the projects can be to really create a dictionary out of it. Isn't it? The kind of metaphors, the similes, the concepts that Baba Saheb Ambedkar has used, they are so, I think they are so deep. So I think, you know, this particular paragraph, last to last but not paragraph, is so important for, you know, each of us as an individual. It is not just applicable to us, but, you know, it is applicable to all the human beings, isn't it? So, coming to this, also the last paragraph is so important. The last paragraph is also so important in terms of where do we put women? Are we prepared to admit women in the army? Are we prepared to see women as butchers? Isn't it? Are we, you know, like how that will go against the idealization of the women that has been created by the dominant cultures, like the pop culture, the the commodification of the women's body, isn't it? All that, you know, the glamorous sort of views which are, you know, aura created around women's body, isn't it? So I think, you know, this is sort of, you know, taking a very sharp needle and deflating that balloon, which has been created by the culture, that by the structures, by the religions, and really to see human beings as they are, with their infinite potential, with their infinite abilities, and the class within, within themselves. I think this is so beautifully put up. So any system of classification, be it Chaturvarna. Chaturvarna is very heinous. It has been backed by the force, by the penal courts. For example, if an individual wants to ride a horse, your caste will decide whether you want to ride a horse or not. Isn't it? If an individual wants to grow a mustache, their own body hairs, and they are entitled to whether grow it or, cut it. It is their individual choice, isn't it? But if the society tells you that, you cannot grow a mustache, you cannot ride a horse, you cannot eat this food, you cannot think these thoughts. Okay, thinking particular thoughts is sort of a privilege to a certain class of people, isn't it? I think, and to serve is a lot that befalls on certain class of people. I think this is very anti-human. The caste system, even the Chaturvarna system, is so anti-human, isn't it? So I think this beautiful ideas, the beautiful concepts have to be really brought into the discussion, into arguments, because they are so important for all of us individually, whether we belong to one class or caste, doesn't matter. It's a reflection on an individual. It's a reflection on every human being. Right. So I think that is what I wanted to just reflect on it, and I think we should reflect more on this.
They wanted to establish Chaturvarna, and to establish that even killing of people was considered not a minor thing. To establish Chaturvarna, the killing of people was like sacred. No, they have given example. Baba Sahib has given example that Rama killed Shambhuka, and we should not blame him, blame the Rama. It was considered as his duty to kill Shambhuka to maintain Chaturvarna, to establish Chaturvarna.
So this brings us to a very important discussion that can we be enslaved? Can an individual be enslaved? We, who are participating in this discussion today, can we be governed by the thoughts, the classification imposed by others, or as an individual human being? Aren't we free to develop our own capacities, our own abilities, our own faculties, the way we like it? And that ties up with the liberty. So the liberation that we are talking about, the liberty that we are talking about, is a choice of an individual to be what they can be, to be what they are capable of being. And, as Baba Ambedkar says, that every individual has this potential. Each of us has this potential. Potentially, we can be what we want to be. And no one can dictate us the directions of our potential. No force on the earth can dictate what we can be, isn't it? So I think this awakening of will of an individual towards his or her potential and its actualization of that potential is so important. And the caste system or Chaturvarna or any system of classification is in direct conflict with the individual. A Brahmin can be a very good manual scavenger, isn't it? They might be endowed with such a capability to clean, isn't it? But a priori you have decided that they cannot do it. Isn't it? Only a class of people, even if they are capable of being an Einstein, you are asking them to sweep.
This point exactly about the potential of human being was elaborated by Dr. Rajkumar Songa in that webinar about the elephant, tied to a small chain. Like it has been, tied to a small chain, when it grows up, it is not able to free itself and realize its true potential. And Baba Sahib was a living example of how a human being can really get out of all this so-called restrictions.
Yeah.
And explore full potential. Yeah. And regarding Rama's story, am I audible?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, now, yes.
Yeah, regarding that Rama story about killing Shambhuka. Hello?
Yes.
It's audible. Regarding Rama's story about killing Shambhuka. After killing Shambhuka, Rama was cursed and his brother would be killed in a very horrific way. So Rama gets depressed and walks into the Tarayu River and he commits suicide. And that's the end of the story of Rama. But once you, when a king commits suicide, he is not intended to be a Brahmin or he doesn't intend to be the become a god. But that is a true story, but which is not being shared by the Hindu people. That is one of the stories I want to this context.
If there are any urgent comments, we will take it now in the next 2 or 5 minutes. And I have a few words to say if we do not have any more comments on this section. There is so much to reflect and so much to digest. So maybe we have to think about all these things, you know, in our individual lives, in our personal lives, think through it, read it again and again, because, you know, this sort of speeches we have to read again and again. Because, you know, there are so many layers of meanings there, that and the language, and, you know, we have to sit with the dictionary, you know, understand the concept. So I think, you know, this demands rereading, rereading all the time. So if there are no urgent comments, can I take your 5 minutes?
Can I say something, please?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I wanted to share something while working on Manu's Madness and for everybody. I will take 5 minutes of your time if it is okay with all of you.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. So while going through the Manu's verses Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar put forth in all his writings and speeches in 17 volumes available, it was emotionally draining to read Manu's Madness over inhuman laws and his deceptive psychology. Many of you would find it weary, and all of us know that Manu was mad. Then why study built up and spent 10 to 12 days of 6 active people's work to make Manu's Madness is the question. In these challenging times for entire world. Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. In these challenging times for entire world, when the problems have stood up in front of all humanity and it's not artificially built based on racism or caste, the problem is real here. Also, it has given the opportunity to take a stand with the revolution against racism with George Floyd's death, wherein white people stood by black protesting against government. That's the revolution. People found strength and unity which give rise to the statue fall. Protesters teared down Christopher Columbus statue in saying this is right thing and right time to do it. In our school, we have studied the Columbus Gavagit. So until now, we knew that he was good person with big achievement, isn't it? And we proudly wrote essay on Anantam Chi Dheya Sakti Ananda Nasha Kinarat Tula Pamarala, meaning infinite our goal, our obsession, and infinite hopes. It's you, ocean, that got the bank. Slave trader statue fall in London is another example. So why statue fall? Because when statue falls, it symbolizes the fall of inhumanity and such fall of such thinking, giving rise to well-being of society and right change. This is example set in front of us nowadays, where one black death gave rise to Black Lives Matter's monumental movement. To affirm, to say no, this will not do. Because it was not just about one person's death, but the entire racism issues happening from centuries, but just being captured nowadays. In Dr. B.R. Ambedkar's language, when the foreigners in West countries are moving towards the equality and liberty with perfect fraternity, in India, the situation is completely twisted and turned up. You might have seen the pictures of foots of mazdoor walking thousands of barefoot, carrying ill mother on shoulder to go home. Why that person and his mother felt safe where? Why didn't that person and his mother feel safe where they were? Little children are trying to wake up dead mother in railway station. Why didn't the hardworking mother got food in railway when it was announced that everyone will get food while traveling? One would get teary-eyed seeing farmer wife and husband were being pulled and beaten by forced policemen, destroying their built-up farm and having poison. Children crying over their bodies. The picture is ugly, isn't it? But it is happening. There is suffering. If we think about its origin, one will get its Manu's madness. Digging deep down, it's rooted in the Manu's verses in Manusmriti, to whom people follow it blindly still today. If it was not that important, the Manusmriti Dahan would never have been happened by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. The scholars residing in cities might not have got affected economically like poor, but take the latest happening, which will affect one and all, no matter rich or poor. Now with the syllabus changing the text for academics in school, if we are not aware of what's wrong and let that happen in our own ignorance, we are equally responsible to let that happen to our children and the generations to come. If our children will not know the history, then how they can pass it over? It's the question to think about. It's not only think, but come up with ways to spread awareness. Eye-opener Manu's Madness reference manual is one such way. It will be great if Brahmin's friends realizes it's especially women and live leading life based on such Manu's mentality and join us to spread the awareness. That's where the change will begin. Again, coming to women, mostly it is found that men tell women that you got potential and you are able to do whatever you want to be. But when in actuality women comes to the same level, I don't think men take it so wisely or easily. But for revolution to happen, it must be propagated through various mediums. Writing is such strong and powerful medium. I urge all of you to write an article by referring the Manu's Madness reference manual. All of our team would like to read your articles. Thank you for listening.
Pucha, that was a very nice sort of a comment. Actually, I was going to talk on that only. And thank you so much for preparing such a thought-provoking analysis for us. I think you did a wonderful job. So my 3 minutes. I can finish it now. 3 minutes. Number one is I feel extremely happy and proud to tell you that our VRG team members have done a wonderful, wonderful job of going through writing and speeches of Baba Saheb Ambedkar and produced a very important manual, I would say, to understand various references of Manu in Baba Saheb Ambedkar's writing and speeches. And that was a job well done. They took, all of them took so much efforts and they did it so professionally that they cross-checked with each other and they ran it like a project, which also encouraged me to go for other projects, very important projects, which I will not talk much about it today, but I would like to put on records the great work that the team of Manu's Madness reference manual has done. And I think we should, I don't know how we can celebrate their success, but they have really, really done a remarkable job. And I think this work will be so useful for people to, as a redirector, to look into the Manu's code and to bring out the meanness of Manu in front of the people. I think why this manual was important and is still important is to, as Baba Saheb Ambedkar has said in the beginning of Annihilation of Caste, know the truth as truth and untruth as untruth. So we cannot discard untruth. We have to look at the source of the ideas. And the poisonous source of ideas lies in the Manusmriti, and they have done a wonderful job Thank you so much, Rucha ji, and Shashank, and Uma, and Mitesh, and Nivedita, and Prashant, and am I forgetting a few names? I think that is it. And they really have worked very hard on this project. And you know, kudos to you and congratulations to you all. And we will be using it again and again. The second point is, out of the discussion that we had in the past, we came up with the idea of a beautiful, beautiful idea. That is the virtual museum, which will showcase the atrocities and the kind of pains that has been heaped upon our people. Basically, you know, this the Jews have done it. They have developed the Museum of Tolerance in several places, and they have recreated the pains and the concentration camps through which the Jews have gone through. So brother has taken a lot of efforts into you know, particularly Brother Pankaj, because he has taken this idea to his heart, and he has developed a wonderful plan of action to develop this virtual museum. And we had a meeting where a small team is constituted, but we thought that this idea might appeal to a lot of you. So we have been thinking that we can have a team a presentation led by Pankaj on virtual museum. And this weekend, maybe tomorrow or a day after tomorrow, we will have a session where the team will be presenting how they would like to go about the virtual museum. And the ideas are now being concretized. And we would like to have all of your inputs. So Pankaj, can you say a word or two about this upcoming meeting, Pankaj?
Sure, Mangesh bhai, sure. You know, this is thanks for putting this. Actually, the best of the, you know, the appeal is at least people to see the concept first and to understand how this online museum will look like. Ultimately, the goal is, you know, we want to understand each atrocity maker or even the experience holder what that atrocity really means to each individual. And you know, we are projecting as a tool towards annihilation of caste. So, you know, we don't see any failure for this project, but you know, the presence of individual. So I sincerely urge everyone at least to listen to the concept. And you know, why we're putting it to VRG, you know, because we want a core team from this group, and we are reading AOC now. So it will be really a good project to take ahead. It is a novel concept, basically.
What will be the objective, means? I did not understand. Objective?
It is based on the same objective, ma'am, where, you know, we are experience holder. We know atrocity has happened. But in that, the main objective is to realize or to get the feel of that atrocity, what it means to an human being. And we are, you know, how the website will be, the contents, the effects. That is a concept which we want to talk in details, you know. So maybe if our friends attend that, it will be a really good to answer all the things.
Yes. Yeah. So why you know, we will circulate a link. Maybe we will have a meeting tomorrow or a day after tomorrow of a museum team, and you are all are requested to join in. So that you know, even if you don't want to participate, is okay, but just listen to the idea, get a feel of it, and we will take it off from there.
Yes. Now having,
yeah, Pankaj, anything?
No, that's all. You put it all the words.
Yeah.
Harsh is also there, Sangadina. So yeah. This team we will frame up. It's a team is there. Initial team is there.
One of the ideas that has been popping up in the group is some of you are very interested to make your own presentations on the AOC, and I would personally encourage that when we finish this book reading, if you have any presentation to be made for the group, that would be wonderful. And if you want to do that, you know, have a modern interpretation or analysis of AOC, your thoughts, I think we should devote an entire session of 2 hours for people to share their ideas and what kind of a practical things that we can do in the future for the community. So you please think over, all of you, and if you have things in your mind which you would like to share at the end of the reading, maybe a presentation, I think that would be wonderful. So I will be waiting for that from all of you, you know, those who are at least interested in presenting their ideas. So I hand it over to Anuradha and Sonika to conclude.
Sir, Songa sir has raised hand.
Who?
Rajkumar Songa sir. Sir, please.
Songa sir.
Hi. Can I just take a minute on...
Yes, sir. Please.
It's my first day and I'm quite excited to be in this group. It's fantastic. Thanks to Mangesh sir for such a wonderful explanation and unpacking the whole thing. And of course, all of you to organize. One of the thoughts we had in our group, which Dr. Venkatesh had started with the doctors and AIIMS, the thought came up about a real museum actually. And we had no clue when we were discussing that there was a virtual museum planned in the process for a similar purpose. I was referring to the Auschwitz museum that Mangesh Saab was talking about, and the kind of impact it has had on humanity, because Holocaust is being denied in 60 years of time. In the US, there are Holocaust deniers, as if nothing has happened. So it is going to be the atrocities against the Dalits would be a forgotten entity each day. It is just one little news in a corner and it'll go away. It is good to crystallize into a hall of shame, I would say. It's not a hall of fame, where we would actually have a physical entity of a building. Maybe Nagpur would be a good choice, or whatever you, that you would think of. It'll be an amazing monument instead of building tall statues. To be able to crystallize and put it up as a monument of shame for this nation against what's been happening. That would actually raise the conscience of people and also the knowledge as to what exactly is happening. Many of them think they know, but they don't. And it is interesting to note, after the Holocaust, the attitude of the Germans, it was like this, that every child was taught the national shame that they had to go through for what they did as supermen towards the so-called inferior Jewish people. What is India's conscience doing? No, it is, ours is nothing but prolonged Holocaust of 3,000 years or beyond. That was maybe 10 years of Holocaust, where 11 million people are affected. Here, I was counting, it was coming to about 100 crores. If you look across 200 crores, looking across 120 generations.
Yeah.
I think somewhere, if we could label it as a Holocaust, it'll have an international appeal. Also, it is true that it is a Holocaust, because there the bodies were burnt, here the souls are burnt. So I think it's, in a sense, a similar scenario. I hope that someday, if the intellectuals in this group and in IIDF take it across to a physical reality, it would be an amazing thing for our own community to look at those atrocities, and also for the others to understand where they stand. And the other point is that it would also be not just looking at the negatives. We could also have a hall of celebration where we could celebrate all the greats of the Dalits over the years and centuries. So it's a hall of fame and shame together, which would be amazing. So I just wanted to share this briefly. Thanks for the opportunity.
That prompted me to share one thought, because, you know, my brother Songa Rajkumar has said something in my mind, and, you know, there I will, this is a personal story. once I met one congresswoman, her name is Alison Schwartz, and she was congresswoman from Philadelphia. And I was told that, you know, when you meet her in White House, you know, these politicians have a very short attention span. So you have to grab her attention in 1 or 2 seconds. So I found that she was from a Jewish background. So I went to her and I told her, I just uttered a few words and her attention was completely captured. So I told her that, you know, ma'am, in our country, there is a Holocaust every day. So she said, what kind of a Holocaust you have? So I told her, you know, we spell Holocaust like H-O-L-O-C-A-S-T-E. You know, there is a concentration camp in every village in our country where our people are put into outside the villages and, you know, the atrocities are committed. So, yeah, Holocaust. So that was the word, you know, I used. And, you know, she was immediately taken. You know, she said, okay, what should I do? Don't take it out of this group. But she is anti-India. And she said, you know, what we should do? So I told her that, you know, every time when you talk about the human rights in bilateral relationship with China, all the time you bring about human rights violation in China. And you never do that in India. You know, you never do that for India. You have this bilateral relationship with India. You never shame India in your diplomatic relationship. You never talk about the caste. You never talk about the atrocities committed on our people. So she said, ah, that's a good point, you know. And that time this nuclear proliferation treaty was taking place. And she was so opposed to India's entry into it. Because I don't know why she hates India, but, you know, she hates India so much. So, you know, I was like telling her, and she's from a Jewish background. So the point that I'm trying to make it, this kind of words and this kind of museum are so important, particularly for creating the awareness, as Brother Rajkumar has said, very rightly said. And physical, Rajkumar Bhai, we were thinking of a physical museum, but we thought that, you know, it's capital intensive. At the same time, it has a geographical limitation. But if we can create a virtual museum that can fly across the borders, isn't it?
So yes,
let's begin with this virtual thing and then we will go for the physical thing.
Yes, yes. I think the virtual idea of a reach is instantaneous and just crosses geographical boundaries. But as a different role, The physical museum, I think, will have its own, yes.
We will have it. We will have it in a place where the worst crime were committed against our people.
Yes.
Like Karmachedu, Khairlanji, or Jahanabad, you know, where, you know, our people were massacred, like, you know, a good idea. So, you know, join the meeting, Rajkumar Bhai. When, we will send you a link, please join in.
Thank you.
please join. Please join to listen the concept. Yeah.
So, Anuradha Solika.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for all of you for joining today's session. And a special thanks to Mangesh sir, Pankaj sir, Songa sir, and Rucha ma'am for their innovative ideas. And definitely, I will request everyone to please join the session, which will be held today or tomorrow or day after that. With that, thank you so much. Jai Bhim to all of you.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, JV.